of the Crown Gem of Cleveland, Ohio. It looks like our guest is not going to be able to join us this morning, but that's okay. Maybe something happened. So let's pray for him just in case, because we don't know. We don't know what people are going through. Father, we just come before you right now in the mighty and majestic name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And Father, we lift up Elder E. Richard, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. And you know his situation. You know what's going on there. You know why that he wasn't able to make the broadcast and be able to give us a morning cup of word. But Father, we thank you for him anyway, and Lord, whatever he's going through, Lord God, we know that you're there, and we ask that you will protect him, shield him and his family, and Father, just meet every need according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And Father, we just bind Satan right now in the name of Jesus, and we just break the power of the adversary right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we know that you know his situation, his circumstance. We don't know. But Father, we thank you for him anyway, and we ask that you continually to bless his ministry in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Because you never know, saints, what people are going through. Like I said, I had a friend here recently that she just passed away. She was a doctor, and I used to go to her. I went to her a lot about a lot of things. And I didn't know she was sick. And I didn't find out that she was sick. In fact, she didn't tell none of us. None of us knew that she was sick until she passed away. And when she passed away, I was like, wow, all that education she had, and which shows you that education means nothing. And she died at a young age. I believe I was older than her. And she died at a young age, very educated, you know. And it kind of threw all of us for a loop. And so I just don't assume. I just pray. And I try to cover everybody with prayer. And it kind of like changed me. Her death changed me. I'm not the same since she has passed away. God used her death to give me life. And to give me a new way of looking at things, because it could have been me. And so in her death, I kind of like grew. And one of the reasons why I cleaned off my Facebook, because I'm not going to be going through my stream reading the mess and putting in my spirit Obama garbage from people that are supposed to be evangelicals, they're supposed to be born-again believers, that should be praying for him. And they can't seem to understand that some of us are defending him, not because we agree with same-sex marriage. I don't. Not because I agree with abortions. I don't. But the truth of the matter is, he is not the sole responsibility to what has happened to our country. We all are participants in the moral decline of our country, including myself. And many a times I've had to go to the Lord and express to the Lord, look, I'm sorry that I have not done my part to make United States a better place to live in. We all are responsible. Jesus told them when they were taking the woman and had brought her in the middle of the street, and we're going to stone her. And that's pretty much what you're doing to him. And Jesus said, he that has not sinned, cast the first stone. I don't agree with it. But I don't think that in my disagreement on a lot of things, I don't have to degrade and demoralize a person and to slander their name and their reputation. That is not of God. That's of the devil. And you don't want to use your lips like that, because Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And that's not a demonstration of love. So what I did was I removed them. And I don't care. They can, you know, they're a so-called pastor. That's all right. I don't need your approval to preach the word of God. I don't need it. Only approval I need is God's approval. I don't need man's approval. It's not man who ordains. It's not man that I have to stand before, in front of, and give an account to my life. But it's God. So your opinions don't mean nothing, and I'm not going to argue with you. I just remove you because I don't want that kind of spirit on my Facebook. So I removed a lot of people. I said what I had to say. I had one person called the Bible a lie. Was talking about Horus. Horus is a demon god that the Egyptians worshipped. And he doesn't understand. He doesn't read his Bible. If you read your Bible in Revelations and in Genesis, the beginning and the end, you will find that the Bible tells us and lets us know that Jesus was slain at the foundations of the world. In other words, before you and me were even set foot on the face of this earth, or before our parents even met, Jesus died for us, and his blood cleanses us, and his blood washes us and makes us whole. So to go around and to bring this type of false doctrine and then to say that the Bible is a lie is to call God a lie. You cannot stay on my site. You cannot be. I don't want that type of influence on my site. I'm sorry. I don't want that. I don't want that in my site. You have to go. So I removed them. So I've been doing a lot of house cleaning and a lot of praying. I talked to God heavy this morning over these people. I said, Lord, what is going on? And God gave me some answers. There's a lot of fear going on. This is why you see the people all of a sudden got to have all these stockpiles of weapons, and they're going around building bomb shelters and stuff like this. And I've heard that through Mike Huckabee posted it, and then I told people about the number 13 that apparently, and I'm going to turn more here towards the camera, apparently Iran has a nuclear capability. This is the rumor. I don't know if it's true because I'm not in Iran. And I told a lot of people, I says, if Iran is going to get nuclear capability, it'll probably be 2013. And I started showing them the Bible and started teaching about the law of first mention and started showing what the Bible says. And so I put two and two together, and I says, if they're going to have nuclear capability, it will probably be this year when they finally have it. So the rumor is that they finally do have it, and people are panicking. But I'm here to tell you that you can go to Jim Baker and buy all the canister of food and everything you want, and you can try to call yourself. Hold on 1 second. Praise the Lord.
Good morning, my sister. How you doing?
We're fine, and we're on the air. I'm glad that you're here. I was praying. We were praying for you because I didn't know what had happened, and we're on the air right now. And as I was telling my listeners, I had a friend who's a medical doctor. She was at the VA hospital, and she passed away 3 weeks ago. She was a doctor. And I didn't know she was sick. I didn't know it was that serious. And so when I see something, what I do now is I pray. I make certain that I pray. So I started praying for you on the air because I didn't know what had happened. And we're 15, 16, and I learned from her. She changed my life. Her death really changed my life. So I'm going to give the pulpit over to you and tell the listeners something about yourself, about your ministry. Let them know how they can reach you and how they can get in contact with you. And if you have a church, we're in your area where they can go to be ministered by you and your members of your fellowship. So I'm going to turn. Let me set this up real quick because I'm going to turn this over to you. And let you have your way. And just remember that at 7:50, make that altar call. Go for
it. Not a problem at all. We can make it all happen. First of all, let me apologize for my lateness. I'm trying to scramble to So I said, well, if I'm early, I'll find out. And if I'm late, I'll be in trouble. But blessed be to God, I'm Elder Ernest E. Richard, Jr., a.k.a. Radio Name Preacher 719. Basically, I'm hailed from the, I'm a native of New Haven, Connecticut, currently residing in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Our church is TC, Walking in the Word Prophetic Ministries, which is located on 75 Columbia Street in the city of Bridgeport, where the senior pastor is Apostle Rosa H. Joyner, and basically ordained minister of some 26, 27 years, been on the battlefield that long. Also a program director for a radio station here in the Connecticut area, as well as a gospel announcer, radio host, MC, Access TV talk show host, also a chief operating officer for what's called the Hollaback Gospel Music Awards, which is located here in the great state of Connecticut, and so many other things that God has blessed us to do. We thank God for this opportunity to share a word with you. And I was sitting there, last night was one of those nights where, I don't know if this ever happens to anybody else, but it happens to me from time to time. When you get excited about the word, you can hardly sleep. It's like a boxer.
Amen.
Getting ready to go into the ring, and he has to sit there and wait for all the formalities before he can actually make his entrance in the ring. And then when it's time to go and he finally gets there, I guess he just kind of calms himself and finds himself in a situation where he's just actually able to get ready to go. But we do thank God for this opportunity and to share. Yes, I want to say good morning to you, the listening audience, and everybody that's around and surrounded, wherever you may be listening to. It's our pleasure to have you here this morning, and we're going to get ourselves prepared to get into the word, because there is a word from the Lord, and I do believe that it's a word today that's going to minister to the masses and be a blessing to everybody that that has the opportunity to listen to this word. We thank God for you and you being with me today, and I said that three times, but I said it for a good reason.
Amen.
I'm trying to get my Bible open as I'm talking to you.
All right.
For those of you that are able to get to a Bible, I'm going to ask that you would open your Bible to the book of Job, about chapter 2. We're only going to take just a few verses out of the book of Job. We're going to be kind of brief with it, and Job chapter 2, verses 3 through 6 says this: And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in all the earth, a perfect man, an upright man, one that feareth God, and escheweth evil, and still he holdeth fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without cause? And Satan answered the Lord and said, Skin for skin, yea, all that a man hath will he give for his life. But put forth thine hand now, and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse thee to thy face. Verse 6, And the Lord said unto Satan, Behold, he is in thine hand, but save his life. I want to go right back to that third verse, because that's going to be the key verse for where we're going to take our text from. It says, And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil, and still he holdeth fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without cause? If I had to, saints, just grab a quick subject or something to that effect, I just want you to know, many of you are going through a lot of different things, a lot of different type trials, troubles, and tribulations, and many of you Christians, although you have a strong desire to be mightily used of God in some power-packed, life-changing way, yet it seems like when it comes down to basically enduring the test that you go through, or withstanding those trials that you have to put up with, or finding yourself trying to persevere through that persecution, sometimes like a cheap suit, many of us tend to just start tearing at the seam. Oh, it seems like you got it all together, and it seems like everything seems to be working in your favor, but the very second everything starts going wrong, that's when you start singing your little sad song. I'm here to let you know, and this is the subject for this morning's service or this morning's message.
All right, it's a setup.
You need to recognize that God wants to put a level of confidence in you.
Yes.
God wants to present you over to the principalities and the powers of the air. And if you ever had an opportunity to look at Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10, it says, now did he intend unto the principalities and powers might the manifold wisdom of God be manifested. God wants to take the time to show you off to the powers and the principalities of the air. You keep in mind there is an accuser out there. His name is Satan.
That's right.
We know him as Lucifer. You read about him in the 14th chapter of Isaiah, and you also read about him in the 38th chapter of Ezekiel. You can get a little information on him as to what he was and what he has become. He is the father of lies. He's known as the accuser of the brethren. He's the old serpent, the devil. He's known as Satan. He has so many different names. Constantly, continuously, he's an adversary to you, constantly trying to find a way to get up under your skin to prove to God that there is really nothing to you. And here you are allowing him to just use you on a moment's notice. Some of you are sitting out there in traffic right now and somebody cut you off and you don't already gave place to the enemy because you started using those famous four-letter words, telling people off just because they got one car space ahead of you. Well, I want to take this time and this opportunity to examine the life of a man who understood what it took to stand in the midst of adversity, a man who knew what it meant to be able to withstand and maintain his integrity. Now, when you look in the book of Job, the story tells us of a God-fearing man by the name of Job, and the Bible gives us clear description and a clear picture pertaining to Job's character by telling us that he was first and foremost a perfect man, which means that Job was basically blameless, a man who was without blemish, a man who was morally sound. The Bible also declares Job to be a man who was upright, meaning that he was straight in the sense of not deviating from God's living standard. We also learn this about this man, Job, that he revered, or he had a high level of respect or reverence or fear, as the word says, for God, and that he abstained or eschewed, as the word said. If you want to use another word, he shunned evil. Now, this man was said to have been one of the wealthiest men of his time.
All right, now.
The resume that Job carried in his day, we may not be able to understand it, so let me help you in this particular sense. Let's start here. The man, first of all, had 10 children, 7 sons, 7 being the number of perfection, and he had 3 daughters. This man had 7,000 sheep, which provided both food and clothing for not just his family, but for those families and those servants whom he housed. He had 3,000 camel, which provided milk as well as transportation, 1,000 oxen, of which 500 were bulls. And they were used for plowing and for other various farm work as well as mating. He also had 500 donkeys. He had several hundred servants and men servants and women servants, along with a huge amount of land acreage. To try to get you an idea of how wealthy Job was, Job's land probably equals about 3/4 the size of the state of Rhode Island.
Whoa.
For those of you that want to go check a map out. Now, when you look at this biblical account of Job's life, it tells of a heart-wrenching story, of a man who went from a riches to rags and then back to riches episode. A man who endured what we would call a nightmare.
Yeah.
And then we find the things that Job suffered through, and although he went through all this thing, we also could see in the midst of that story that it displays the picture of a man whose faith was under fire, a man who endured these particular sufferings, a man who remained steadfast and stable under these conditions. Now, recently, over here in the East Coast, we just recently went through a snowstorm or a blizzard, but But even more recently than that, we found ourselves dealing with the effects of Hurricane Sandy. And
many of us
here on the East Coast, and those of you who are listening to me now around the world and over there in the great state of Ohio, you probably witnessed on your television screens the snapping of trees as if they were toothpicks. And you saw even larger trees wrenched from the ground and whole houses pulled off their foundations, whole roofs sailing through the sky, and cars and trucks being tossed around as if they were toys. There were great swells of waters, and in some cases as high as 10 feet, filling some houses to the place of point where it reached the second, and even in some cases the third floor. Now, understanding these natural disasters and their ability to cut and tear and to run their course and to do the damage that was done, the path of destruction had been, and when the path of destruction had been completed, all you can usually see from the end of this, especially with the houses, was basically the existence of that solid foundation. And that's how that foundation survived and went through all that brutality and all that fierceness and that unbridled fury of that storm. Now, there's something I'm trying to get to here. You see, these foundations can be used basically for the rebuilding of that particular house even after that storm.
Come on,
what I'm trying to get to you today is that the human life is something like a building, and whether that life has the stability, whether that life is like it has that stability to proceed in an unstable fashion, or literally depends on whether the quality of the foundation. Well, let me make myself a bit more clear, because I don't like the way I just said that.
What I'm trying
to get you to understand is, like that particular building, these human lives have the ability to sustain storms, but the condition of that foundation that life is built on will determine what you have put into that life that you put out there. Now, for any natural structure, we understand as humans that there must be a firm foundation, one that's first of all rooted and grounded and planted to the place and point where it's not only able to withstand the weight of that building, but other building-related stresses as well. Now, if a contractor, for some strange reason, decides to use cheap materials to erect that structure, this contractor runs the risk of that building possibly collapsing and serious damage taking place. And often we as Christians, and I'm going to throw non-Christians in the mix as well, we tend to use inferior materials to construct our lifestyles. And when those storms of life start raging against us, when the billows start rolling and that hard rain starts to come down, those trials, those troubles, that temptation, and all those things start coming, many people find themselves crumbling like that very building. In the middle of their trial, they're stumbling and they find themselves falling apart in the process of that calamity they're going through. Some are ready to throw in the towel at the first sign of trouble. And then there's that certain few, that certain handful who have the understanding of what it means to endure hardness. As a good soldier of Jesus Christ, there's that small remnant that have come to the point and place that they've made up in their minds that even though they may possibly lose all their material possessions, they may experience some health issues, they might find themselves out of place with their loved ones, they might lose their power, they might lose their prestige, they might lose their social status, but they understand that they hold onto God's unchanging hand.
That's right.
They know that somehow God is going to bring them through that all.
That's
now,
right.
Getting back to my man Job here, Job was severely tested on two different levels.
Yes, he was.
First, in his material possessions.
Well,
I named all those things earlier that Job had to get you to understand that this man had a lot to lose from a materialistic possession. Too many of us are wrapped tight and tangled in our houses, our cars, our lands, our investments, bank accounts, and all kinds of crazy stuff, and not recognizing that God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think. God has the ability to give back any and everything that you could possibly lose. The second thing that this man Job went through was his actual personal health. So we're looking at his physical possessions, we're looking at his mental stability. This man had everything in life had to offer, and this man suddenly found himself under the attack and being assaulted on every side, utterly devastated and brought down to his very Now, to examine what this man had been through should cause you to see what his life was. We understand that Job's life was not built on his accomplishments. Job's life was not built on his ability. His life was not built on his influence over others. Job's life was not built on his talents. Job's life was not built on his treasure.
Well,
this man's life was built on the absolute trust and confidence in the living God of Abraham. Excuse me. I'm going to say Abraham.
That's all right.
Abraham and Isaac.
We know what you're saying.
But his absolute trust in the confidence of the living God of Isaac, Abraham, Jacob, the same God who delivered Joseph. Now, Satan was allowed to destroy Job's home. He was allowed to take away his children. He was allowed to take away his servants. He was allowed to take away his livestock. He was allowed to kill his herdsmen. He was allowed to devastate his physical being. But Job never lost his faith, and Job never lost his integrity in God. You see, God knew Job's character and was able to say to Satan, as he said in that verse 3, "Hast thou not considered my servant Job?" My friend, I've got to ask you a question today. Can God say that about you?
Whoa.
God's waiting to brag on some of you. God's waiting to talk about some of you. The enemy's out there. The Bible says your adversary, the devil, walketh about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour.
That's right.
And God wants to brag on some of you, but is he able to? We have to ask ourselves this question. Nobody can answer that question better than you can. Can God trust you to the place and point that he knows that behind the scenes, when nobody's watching, when there ain't nobody there, when there's nobody around, that you're still going to have that level of integrity, that you're still going to have the characteristic to display and manifest the wisdom, the word, and the way of God? Can God trust you? See, some people can't handle trials, and some people can't handle tribulations or persecutions.
Right.
They can't handle setbacks.
That's
they
right.
can't handle calamities. They can't handle tragedies. They can't handle other life-related disturbances, and that's primarily coming from the fact that it depends on what you use to build your house.
Well,
I want to talk a little bit about something out of the book of Matthew, where Jesus talked about two different types of houses and the foundations they were built upon. Now, those of us who have, and let me give you a little bit of story for those of you that may not remember, in the book of Matthew, the 7th chapter, verses 24 through 27, Jesus mentioned two types of houses. One was built on a solid foundation, the other was built on sand. And he talks about a storm coming, and that storm raging very mightily to the place and point where one house stood in the midst of that storm, and the other house just utterly collapsed and fell. Those of us who allow the Lord to build our houses, there's a passage of scripture in the book of Psalms that says, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain. And when it's talking about house in this particular situation, it's talking about your lifestyle. Those of us who allow the Lord to build houses or to build their house or to build their lifestyle find themselves still standing in the midst of their storms, still hanging on, knowing that their soul is anchored in the Lord, that they have no desire to give up. They're not worried about the billows rolling and the breakers dashing. They know in whom they believe.
That's right.
And then there are those who try to build their own house themselves, and they witness the great fall of their house simply because their carnal walk with the Lord has found them using inferior materials, which I talked about a little bit earlier. And I just want to give you a quick example of some of the inferior materials that you might be using. If you're one of those who's building your house or building your walk with the Lord with self-reliance, with disobedience, with deception, with mediocrity, with human philosophy, with self-will, with bad attitudes, with foolish opinions, and constantly using stuff that's not going to build you up, but literally tear you down, you are going to find yourself shifting day in and day out. Today you're up, tomorrow you're down. Next week you're to the left side, the other week you're to the right side. You're just not sure where you're going. I think James summed it up the best when he says, an unstable man is like the sea or the waves of the sea. And I'm talking from the Living Bible edition as to how it says, but it's, I believe it's King James says an unstable man is paraphrase, a man who's twisted in his mind is unstable in all his ways.
Double-minded.
God is not able to trust somebody that has a life of that caliber.
Yeah.
God God cannot trust a man whose life centers around self-sufficiency. God can't trust a man whose life is centered around self-purpose.
That's
God
right.
can't use a man whose life is centered around self-satisfaction. God cannot even, don't even want to talk to a man who's centered around self-righteousness. God can't use a man who's just simply selfish.
That's
you
right.
You know, you heard the song by that great writer of our time, William McDowell. Give myself away.
That's
There's
right.
a reason why that man wrote that song, and if you paid attention to it, that song is really based on Luke 6:38 when he talks about giving, it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom.
Mm-hmm.
It says, for with what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you again.
Mm-hmm.
When you begin to give yourself away or give yourself as unto the Lord, there is a return that comes back to you. That type of living that I talked about with the self-sufficiency and all that particular stuff is carnal, which means that it's obvious those who are living for themselves cannot be used by the Lord, because you clearly demonstrated that you're not only unteachable, you, my man, or you, ma'am, are unreachable. And I think the Apostle Paul summed up these individuals the best when he wrote in 2 Timothy 3:7 that they're ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Understanding who God is what he's talking about, and understanding what God is able to do. There is self has to die. There can be no more I if you want to go up in God. The Bible talks about humility. The Bible says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he would exalt you in due season. I want to help you to understand that God wants to set some of you up so that he can show you off by virtue of the fact that your faithfulness in him. He wants to stop the mouth of your accuser. He wants to stop the lies of the devil. He wants to put the devil in check by saying, hast thou not considered my servant? Whoever you are listening, put your name in that spot. Has God, has the enemy not considered you? How there is none like you. You in all the earth. God's looking for someone who will truthfully say, even though they're going through, even though they're in the middle of their trial, they're in the middle of their persecution, they're in the middle of that mess that they're in, that calamity, that tragedy,
mm-hmm.
that disturbance, that thing that's just boggling their mind, they can still say, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because I'm trusting in the Lord with all my heart. I'm not leaning to my own understanding. In all my ways, I'm acknowledging him. God is directing my path. The steps of the good man, the Bible says, are ordered by the Lord. Why? Because I'm delighting myself in his way. I find myself in the midst of trials and troubles and tribulations, and this is you talking, ma'am. This is you talking, sir. When you decide to build on that solid foundation, you can safely say that when you find yourself in the middle of your storm, you say, I'm dwelling in the secret place of the Most High. I'm abiding under the shadow of the Almighty.
Mm-hmm.
I can say to the Lord that God is my refuge. God is my strength. God is my present help in the time of trouble. You've got to refuse to let the devil have a field day in your life just because things aren't going the way you planned them. You've got to recognize that even though you may go through a trial, even though you're going through that tribulation, yeah, they're trying to take your house. Yes, they're trying to repossess your car. Yes, they're trying to take you to court to take away your kids. Yes, your spouse is trying to walk out the door. You can't let none of that disturb you. You've got to turn around and take off that pity party pants that you're wearing, and you've got to put on the garment of praise and get rid of the spirit of heaviness. You have to refuse to have that pity party. Your life is not based upon what you're going through. Your life is not based upon what you've been through. Your past has no right to decide what your future is going to be. You have to remember, my friend, it's a setup. God wants to display your faithfulness to those principalities in heavenly places. You heard me say that earlier. He wants to show you up to the place and point and let the devil know that you are not just some useless pile of flesh that's just taking up space here in the earth realm. God is exposing his many sides of wisdom, or his manifold wisdom, as it says in Ephesians 3:10,
mm-hmm.
to each and every one of you, to the place and point that you are utilizing your gifts, your talents, your abilities, the authority that he's giving you. You've learned how to tread upon serpents. You've learned how to tread upon scorpions. You've learned how to take power over all the power of the enemy. God's given you a lot of weapons to navigate through the disasters of life. I encourage you to stay in the race, whoever you are. This ain't the time for you to throw in the towel. towel. This is not the time for you to give up. This is not the time for you to walk away. This is not the time for you to say, I've had enough. You need to understand that you are so close to your breakthrough. Some of you are going to feel a little bit of pain, but you have to remember that this light affliction is working a more eternal weight in glory. You may find yourself crying through the night. You may find yourself boo-hooing every now and then, but keep in mind that even as the psalmist David said, weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. You have to see the breaking of day. You have to see your way through the dark clouds. There are times when you're going to be in your comfort zone and the ship looks like it's getting ready to get rocked. You need to understand that if the greater one is living on the inside of you, you want Jesus to stand up in you, to come up in you, to speak up in you and tell that storm, peace, be still. You're going to lose some friends. You have to know that there is a friend that's sticking closer than your brother.
Well,
your family's going to turn their back on you. They're going to try to discourage you and try to talk you out of your walk with the Lord. They're going to try to get you to walk away from God. And that's the job of the enemy, to use whatever he can use to make you realize that you don't need God, but you need to keep pressing for the mark of the high call of God in Christ Jesus. You need to stay focused. You need to set your affection on those things above and not on the things of the earth. You need to remember that your life is hid with Christ in God. Right now, you need to recognize that it is not about you. It's all about him. You're his representative. You're an ambassador for Christ. You are a royal priesthood. You're a chosen generation. It is your job to bring forth and show forth the praises of Almighty God through your worship and through your church attendance. That's why the Bible says not to assemble, to forsake the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of such is, because when you start turning around thinking it's all about you and you start staying home and acting like it doesn't matter whether you show up to church or not, and it doesn't matter if you come to Sunday school or not, and it doesn't matter if you go out and help your neighbor, you are letting the enemy beat you down.
That's right.
People are going to hate on you for no reason at all. You just might as well get used to that, because Jesus said on another occasion,
right,
if they hated me, they're going to hate you.
That's right.
You're
going
to lose a little bit of money sometimes.
That's right.
You're
going to
lose a little bit of sleep. In some cases, you're going to lose a bit of hair. But
hey,
keep in mind, it's just a setup. God knows you.
That's right.
God has confidence in you to get whatever the job is that he's giving you done. You can't back down now. You can't walk away now. You can't run away now. God has everything that you're going to have need of to survive. God has everything you're going to need to get through whatever it is you're going through. And for those of you that have lost it, keep in mind with the story of Job, although he lost his children, although he lost his cattle, although he lost his sheep, although he lost his servants, although he lost his herdsmen, although Job lost everything Job could possibly lose, Job kept the faith and Job kept his integrity. But there was one thing you got to remember. There was an end to the beginning of that story.
Mm-hmm.
You see, if you go back and read toward the end of that story in Job, you will find out that later on, Job regained everything that he lost. But he got, as a lot of us like to say, double for his trouble. You have to understand how to hang in there. You have to remain steadfast,
right,
unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord.
Right.
You cannot become weary, because in your due season, you're going to reap if you faint not. You cannot allow the enemy to talk you out of your blessing. That's the devil's job. It's time to stop eating the lies and the what I call the potato chips of the enemy.
That's
junk food he wants to feed you.
Well,
he's trying to tell you, you're supposed to be sick. You're supposed to live in poverty. You're supposed to be poor.
Mm-hmm.
You're not supposed to have the best of the best
mm-hmm.
in the land. That's all a lie from the pit of hell. God wants you to have the best because you belong to the best. I remember the Bible telling me, I believe it was in Psalms 37, that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. That's letting me know right there, my Father owns it all. The Bible tells me also that he owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. So if God owns it all, why am I acting like I can't have any of it at all? There's no need for me to carry on like that. There's no need for me to act like that. I need to recognize and realize that God has caused me to become an inheritance or a co-inheritor with the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm a joint heir, as it says in the book, with the Lord Jesus Christ. And since I'm a joint heir, that makes me a son of Abraham. Ma'am, that makes you a daughter of Abraham. Sir, you too are a son of Abraham. God wants you to have it. crying about it. Stop whining about it. Stop complaining about it. Remember, it's a setup. I like how Peter said, and I'm going to say this part, and I'm going to begin to close and get ready to go to the altar call.
Right,
Peter
now.
Said in 1 Peter 4:12, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing had happened
right.
to you. Verse 13, and I like the first two words in verse 13, but rejoice. Why should you rejoice? Because, A, number one, your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. And number two, God got your back. No matter what you're going through, if you're going through the fire, if you're going through the flood, regardless of whatever it is you're going through, God got your back. And for some of you, God is going to restore everything that you lost. Everything
that's
the canker worm and the palmer worm and eating up everything that the locusts had taken away from you. God is about to restore. Sure, your friends laughed at you and they made fun of you and they ridiculed you while you were going through. But you got to remember this too. I remember David saying this in the 5th verse of the 30th Psalm, I believe it was, or the 24th Psalm, excuse me. He says, thou preparest a table for me in the presence of my enemies. They got a chance to laugh,
that's
but
right.
you're going to end up getting the last laugh.
Well,
my friend, if you've departed from the Lord, if you've walked away from God because of whatever it is that you're going through, if your situation, your circumstance became more than you can bear, I hear the Lord Jesus Christ saying, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden.
Well,
he says, I will give you rest. He's saying, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and I am lowly. My yoke is easy and my burdens are light. God wants you to cast the whole of your care upon him, but even more so important, God wants to have a relationship with you. You see, the Bible tells us in the book of Romans chapter 10, it starts there, it says, but what saith it in verse 8, the word is nigh thee and even in thy mouth. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if thou wilt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, here it is, and it's so simple, thou shalt be saved.
Right.
Now, this is the part I need you to really pay attention to, because a lot of you think you got to jump hoops and run through fire to have a relationship with God. It says no. The next verse tells us that with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. I want you to take a minute, whatever you're doing, stop whatever it is you're doing if you can. If you're driving, just lay your hand on your radio or on your computer, and don't put your Android in your hand, because I don't want you to get no ticket from the police. But just make a point of contact and repeat this after me. Say, Lord Jesus,
I come to you this morning.
I recognize that I'm a sinner.
I recognize I'm a sinner.
Salvation.
And I need salvation.
Save me this day, Lord.
Save me this
Your
day,
Your word
Lord.
Says if I confess with my mouth.
Your word says if I confess with my mouth.
And believe with my heart.
And believe with my heart.
That you raised Jesus from the dead.
That you raised Jesus from the dead.
I would be saved. I believe your word.
I believe your word.
And because I believe your word.
And because I believe your word.
I confess with my mouth.
I confess with my mouth.
This day. I am saved.
I am saved.
I belong to you now.
I belong to you now.
I thank you for saving me, Lord.
I thank you for saving me, Lord.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Let me just pray a quick prayer over you, Father God.
Thank
you for
Lord.
The new converts and for those that have come to you this morning, God. Recognize that they were in need of a Savior. Heavenly Father, I ask that you begin to minister to them, put the right people in their path, thrust the perfect laborers into the paths of all these people, cause them to recognize and to realize that, Father, you already have their life mapped out for them. Father God, I know they're going to run into trials and some tribulations even in the course of this day, but just let them know that you're there to guide them through whatever it is they may be going through. And so, Father, we release them into your hand, into your charge, and into your care, thanking you for the work that you've done in their life, in the work of salvation, in Jesus' name. name we pray. Amen. I'm going to turn this portion into the hands of my dear sister. It is 9 minutes before the top of the hour. I thank you again, Pastor Tate, for this opportunity to share a quick word with your people. And I love you for the openness of your heart. And I bless God for you and the radio ministry to which he's given you.
Amen. But don't leave yet if you can, because I need you. We still got a couple of minutes. And the reason why I want you to do this is because Anna Douglas will tell you, once I get hold of you, everybody's going to hear. There's other sites that this is going to be streamed to, like a sermon.net.com, Speaker Radio. Right now you minister to Facebook. There's 129 groups I belong to, 13 Ning sites, and they all heard you at the same time, and plus Google Plus. So, but there's still other sites like TalkShoe that I'm going to restream this, and also Blog Talk Radio I'm going to restream this to over the weekend. So I need for you to let people in your area, because even though I'm a pastor, I'm still an evangelist at heart. I'm an evangelist pastor, okay?
All right.
Let them know where you're at, where your church is at, and your website, and how they can join you on Facebook and on Twitter. Because I know there's probably people in the New York area that don't have a church home, and the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, forsake not ourselves the assembling of the brethren as the manner of some, exhorting one another as that day approaches. So can you let my listeners know how they can reach you that are in your area, your church affiliation,
yes,
again,
can.
And address,
yes,
and the time of your services?
Okay, I'm at TC, it's Timothy Chapel, Walking in the Word Prophetic Ministries. The senior pastor there is Apostle Rosa H. Joyner. The address for that particular church is 75 Columbia Street in the city of Bridgeport, Connecticut. You can reach me several ways. We'll start with the email address. You can email me at preacher, that's PREACHER 719@gmail.com. You can locate me on Facebook with two different pages. The first page is Elder Ernest Richard. The second page is Elder E. Richard Jr., page 2. The letter 2, the numbers 2 are Roman numerals. You know, the two, I always call it the capital I, you know, just so we'll understand where it is. Also, I can be reached on Twitter at Preacher719. Now, I have a couple of other sites that I could be reached at, but I think those would be the basics. There's another email address, preacher71958@yahoo.com. And then I'm also on LinkedIn, Elder Ernest E. Richard, at LinkedIn, and then the word IN, LinkedIn. And if I'm not mistaken, Pastor, I think that's how we got connected, was through LinkedIn. Am I correct on that?
We got connected through Anna Douglas on her show.
Yes.
Because I'm
that was through LinkedIn.
When I first heard you preach. And I said,
God,
he got to preach over here too. And you're going to be back too. Well.
Thank you. I tried to share something that was on my heart. Now, I want to say this. I know you got a few minutes.
Yeah, we got a couple minutes.
Okay, very quickly, for those of you that heard the President's State of the Union address last night, please pray for our President and for his cabinet, and pray for the things he's trying to get done to be done, because we are still dealing with a somewhat divisive Congress. The effectual fervent prayer of the righteous always avails much. You make tremendous power and ability available by getting on your knees or however it is you need to pray. Hold that man up before God, because God really is doing a work through him.
Yes.
You don't have to agree with everything he's doing.
Right.
You got to remember, he's the president of Christians, but he's also the president of non-Christians.
That's right.
So pray for him. The Bible teaches us to pray for those who are in authority. I encourage you, pray for President Obama, for Vice President Biden, and for their cabinets, and for the work that they're trying to get done. Because it's going to take Jesus, you, and me holding him up, the same way as Aaron and Hur held up the hand of Moses while Israel was in battle.
Exactly. And can I add on to that? Because I have had to deal with a couple of people on Facebook, what they fail to understand as Christians. We, the tongue speak life or death. And we have the ability and the power to pray a person to be formed into Jesus Christ. Paul even said that. He says, I continue to pray for you until Christ be formed in you. So when we see areas in a Christian's life, and President Obama is a Christian, we see areas that he may be weak in, we should pray that Christ be formed in him and really bridle our mouths, that our religion be not in vain. Because in Romans chapter 13, the Bible lets us know that God places magistrates in position. And God has placed him there, whether we like it or not. God placed him there. So therefore, if we're going to be obedient to the word of God, then we have to learn to be obedient and to submit under the authority that God places. And know that God has a divine, what they call, provincial care over us. In other words, God placed him there to get a job done for God. Not for you, but for God. God put him there to get his will done. Not my will, not your will, not the GOP's will, not the Democrats' will. God is sovereign, and he puts who he wants to put in office the way he wants to put it. That's the bottom line. He did it with Cyrus. Cyrus was not saved, but God put him there because he knew that Cyrus would give Israel the necessary funding to go to Jerusalem and build the wall, and he would release them out of Babylonian captivity. So you guys, come on now. Let's quit bad-mouthing the president, and let's quit doing that. That's not love. That's not Christ. So what I did, I weeded some people off of my Facebook. That's why some of my numbers dropped, because I weeded them, because I don't want that spirit on my Facebook. I want people to pray. I'm an internet pastor. I want people to pray and trust God.
The one thing if I can add to what you just said, when the scripture says, touch not mine anointed. Now, the first thing we think about is
now.
Prophets, pastors, evangelists, teachers, you know, and people, apostles,
that's
and people
right.
of that caliber. You have to understand, those whom God puts in authority, that's his anointed.
That's his anointed.
And I'll give you a good example. Saul.
That's right.
Didn't say that Saul was a Christian. It didn't say Saul loved God with all his heart. But David would not allow anybody to touch with their hand or with their mouth King Saul.
That's
King
right.
Saul.
That's
all right,
right,
President Obama, King Saul, same thing. They were the head magistrate.
That's right.
Watch how you talk about it.
Watch how you talk, because the word Christ comes from the word, well, the Greek is Christos, and it comes from the Hebrew word Messiah. And if you go
That's
into
right.
your Strong Concordance or your Strong Dictionary, or if you have a Holtman Bible Dictionary and you look into it, it will let you know that God is talking about government, because he is King of Kings and he's Lord of Lords. And I have some news to tell these pastors out here, that there's no way of trying to separate the church from the state, because God did not create it that way. The church and the state is supposed to, all of us are supposed to submit ourselves under the authority of God. The Bible says that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall say that Jesus Christ is Lord, and people need to look up the definition of Lord. Now, they know Jesus as Savior, but they don't know Jesus as Lord. And you're not truly connected with Jesus until you know him as Savior and Lord. That means obedience. Hallelujah. Hey, well, we better let God win over a little bit.
Bless his name. I just really enjoyed this opportunity.
I enjoyed you. I enjoyed what God is doing with you.
I mean, it's a great way to wake up in the morning.
Yes, it is.
I prayed that your morning cup of word was what you were looking for.
Yes,
you did. You're a cappuccino person.
Yes.
It's going to be your holy cup of cappuccino or espresso or whatever it is you like. I just pray that it was a not just a warm-up call for you, but a
wake-up
call for
you. It was an eye-opener.
It opened
her eyes. Woke them up.
Just look to the Lord, because I mean, I gave you what the Lord gave me, and I don't even have to sit there and wonder, did it or did it not? The word never returns void.
No,
it
doesn't.
Accomplishes that which it's sent out to do, and it always prospers in the thing whereunto it's sent. So with that being said, my sister, I'm going to put it in your hands.
All right.
Final say and the benediction.
Thank you so much. I want to thank the Lord for Elder Ernest E. Richard, and I'm going to, if you missed this or you're just clicking in, we're going to replay it. You can find or hear the teaching on demand on the Crown, on livestream.com, the Crown Gem TV. You can rehear it again, and I'm going to do some editing and put it up on rotation, because I really enjoy this, and I think that everybody should hear that. Thank you for clicking in and joining me for a morning cup of word here on Live365.com, the Crown Gem. And tomorrow, our morning cup of word is going to come from Pastor Christanne. She's going to be bringing forth the word of God. So stay tuned and keep clicking in to Live365.com, the Crown Gem. I've been your host, Pastor Debra Tate. Selah.